Firstly, a very good morning to everyone. And now, today we're going to see esophageal carcinoma. A little bit on epidemiology. In other parts of the world, in like Iran, as you can see, there's a trend here where it's more orange or more red. That's where a higher incidence of esophageal carcinoma occurs in this region here. Mainly because usually to behavioral habits. Like in Iran or in some parts of Afghanistan and the Middle East, they have this habit of drinking tea, which is very hot. So it also leads to esophageal cancer. And in Europe, it's prevalent in Finland, Iceland, and northwestern France. But Robbins and Cotton states there's increasing incidence in Eastern Europe nowadays. And in North America, Western Europe, it's common in blacks, in males after the age of 50, and usually in a lower socioeconomic status. Next up, we can classify it broadly into two separate classifications. One is squamous cell carcinoma, which occurs in the proximal part of the esophagus, mainly in the upper one-third and the mid one-third here. And when it happens in the lower the distal region, it's usually it's not a rule, but it's usually adenocarcinoma. And today I'll be covering squamous cell carcinoma, not much of adenocarcinoma. And squamous cell carcinoma is most commonly associated with alcohol consumption and tobacco smoking. Yeah, and adenocarcinoma is more associated with the reflux diseases like the GERD and Barrett's esophagus. Now my patient, his name is Matthias Ladislav. He's only 43 years old, and his reason for admittance was that he had progressive dysphagia, and this dysphagia developed very quickly over a period of just 3 months, right? And firstly, he wasn't able to eat solid food. Subsequently, he wasn't even able to drink soups. And but nowadays it's okay. He's managing with soup or with tea and stuff. Before it used to cause him a lot of pain, and currently he's under medication to control this pain. And the pain was in the epigastric region. Next up, an important point to note is that there was no history of cancer in his family. So I ruled out familial cancer with the hereditary causes. Now, his habits, which are of concern, is that he smoked about 20 to 30 cigarettes a day for about the past 25 years. And the other thing is, he had a lot of this good stuff, probably too much of it. Twica, he had close to about 1 liter per week. Okay, so these are the two reasons which I think that caused his cancer, as we shall see in the pathophysiology part of this disease. Next up, the history of the disease. He lost 7 kilograms in just 2 weeks, which was very worrying. He had heartburn, and a very significant finding was that he vomited after eating solid food, and most of it was undigested food. So it gives us an idea that that means the food probably never reached the stomach, which is why digestion probably didn't take place. And the pain would start immediately after eating, and it would cease gradually. And the stool was normal. Now, and so he was admitted here in this hospital. He was not from Cluj, he was from out of here. And this variant swallow, as we can see here, shows this carcinoma here in this region. And as we can see here, it is actually there is no dilation, pre-stenotic dilation. This stenosis here, there's no pre-stenotic dilation, which means to say that it has been a sudden onset. Because it was benign and it took over a period of time, then the esophagus would have enlarged. Yes, but this did not take place here, which gives us a prediction of malignancy here. Yeah? And the other thing is that the stenosis has been irregular, as can be seen here. Subsequently, endoscopy was done, an upper tract endoscopy. And what they found is here, you shall see this video, hopefully it starts, it will take some time. Meanwhile, when it starts, yes, you can see that there. Now, this is a protruded type of esophageal carcinoma. As you can see, this white region here. So it completely obstructs the esophagus, causing stenosis of the esophagus. Right? Which is why he has problems swallowing solid food. Now, and I have actually done an animation here to show you the exact location of the carcinoma. It is about 2 cm below the carinal region of the trachea, and it stretches up to about 10 cm, about 10 centimeters below, right? And there are other less common versions of this, a flat excavator, but in our patient's case, it was a protruded carcinoma. Next up, we also did a computed tomography CT to actually get a better understanding of the TNM classification. As we can see here, in these images here, this is the trachea and this is the esophagus that comes right in below. And as you can see here, the obstruction, as I have circled in red, I think it's pretty clearly visible. Right? So it is here that the obstruction occurred. Yes? Now, I talked to the radiologist who has this case, and he says the T classification is about T2 or T3, because the T classification is done better with the echo endoscopy, right? So, but the N and M classification can be done with precision with the CT scan. So, the T classification, we don't know whether the tumor invaded, on this classification, this is the 1983 classification and 2002 classification. So, I'm going to use the 2002 classification by the American Group of Cancer Classification. So we don't know whether the tumor invaded the muscularis propria or whether it invaded the adventitia. So we don't know whether it's T2 or T3 over here. But we definitely know there was a regional node metastasis that was seen in other CT images. What we saw was that there was enlarged pericardial lymph node. So showing that there's been lymph node involvement there. Now, there was no distant metastasis because according to this classification, if there was a distant metastasis, tumors of the lower thoracic esophagus, there must be metastasis in the celiac lymph node. Now, there was no metastasis in the celiac lymph node. So, therefore, we presume that there was no metastasis. So, his classification was T2, N1, M0. And so, therefore, his staging was stage 2A or stage 2B. So with this staging, we came up with the treatment plan for the patient, as we shall move on. Now, the discharge summary states there was a 32 the tumor, location was about 32 cm from the dental arc. As I've already mentioned, it was 10 cm long, it was 2 cm below the carinal region. And there was also a paraesophageal lymph node of 3 cm, which is big, and it was compressing the esophagus. So he was subsequently given medication, analgesic medication, Efen, to ease his pain, and he was recommended surgery. And his diagnosis was esophageal tumor. The histopathology was in the histopathology and the study of the to diagnose it as the adenocarcinoma or squamous cell carcinoma was still in progress at the time. Now the patient then left Cluj. Now, so we'll just cover a little bit on pathophysiology of this disease. Now, how can alcoholic drinks or smoking tobacco cause this disease? As alcoholic, I got this information from Robinson Cotton for those who are interested in further reading. Now, alcoholic drinks contain polyacrylic hydrocarbons, nitrosamines, and these are known agents to cause cancer. Nutritional deficiencies like of vitamin A, vitamin C will also cause cancer. And tobacco smoke produces P53 point mutation, which is where probably his cancer originated from. And why the cancer spread within a matter of 3 months is because of the rich lymphatic network that we have in the region. Okay? And this is a picture of the squamous cell carcinoma, also from Robinson Cotton. Now, so to do an accurate staging, we need to do an endoscopic ultrasonography. Now, as you can see here, this T here is the tumor, and this is the lymph node. So from here, we can see whether the tumor has invaded the muscularis propria or whether it has just invaded the adventitia. From there, we can get a proper TNM staging. Yes? Now, this endoscopic ultrasonography was not done for our patient. He left. Right?